Welcome to the Music EdQuity Chat Show, a show for music educators to go beyond the surface to have deeper conversations about how we can reimagine music education to be diverse, inclusive, and culturally responsive for all of our students. My name is Ashley Cuthbertson, and I am the host of the Music EdQuity Chat Show. I'm a music educator and the founder and CEO of A. Cuthbertson Consulting. We're an educational consulting firm that specifically supports music educators in centering equitable and culturally responsive practices in their curriculum and instruction so that they can build and maintain high quality music programs where all of our young musicians are thriving. And we are officially halfway through our very first season. So thank you to all of you who have been tuning in and joining me live. Let me know also if you're here. Thank you to all of you that are coming back and watching the episodes as they get published. And for everybody who's been sharing, the response to the first half of our first season has been so beautiful. And I thank all of you for your great support. Tonight, I am going to be going solo to talk about unpacking DEIAB in music education. So let's just go ahead and jump right into tonight's episode. So as we head into spring, I've been reflecting on how the first quarter of the year has gone for me and my consulting company, as I have done a ton of travel to work with different music teams all over the country and also to speak at different music education conferences and to plan for the summer and the fall. And so I've had the great privilege of working with music educators all across our country, internationally even, and often I begin my sessions with the question, do you believe that music is for everyone? And so far, nobody has said no. Everybody raises their hand, and of course they do, right? I'm talking to music educators. Music educators become music educators because we want to share the joy, the love, and the power of music education. But that belief doesn't keep us from having an equity problem in music education. And as I was preparing for a keynote that I did a couple weeks ago for the Music Teachers National Association DEI Pedagogy Day Conference, I came across this statistic I wanted to share. According to the Arts Education Data Project, while 92% of students in US public schools have access to music education in their school, an estimated 3,609,698 students do not have that same access. 3.6 million students. And that's actually just public school data. So that doesn't include independent schools. It doesn't include charter schools. And the way that the data set worked, they also didn't drill down to, sometimes at the secondary level, students will have access to music courses, but actually not really because they have to like mandatorily take some, class in their eighth grade year, and it's happening right up against the only time that they would have the choir that they would be into. So while their school has that access, actually they don't have access to it at that time or that year, right? So it didn't drill down that far. It just was looking at schools where music is happening. That same report also revealed that a disproportionate number of students without access to music and the arts education are concentrated in major urban communities, have a high percentage of students who are eligible for free and reduced price meals, and that those students are usually majority Black, Hispanic, or Native American. Now, if you've been with me for a while, those three things probably are not surprising to you at all, right? We're here talking about equity, so we know that our most marginalized students have the least access to music education. So that part of the statistic was not shocking to me, but the 3.6 million certainly was. Research also tells us time and time again how learning music results in cognitive, social, emotional, even physical benefits, right? Learning music results in better test scores. Research has even found that students who have access to music education at their schools are less likely to struggle with attendance issues. In fact, they want to go to school more when they have music and arts programs at their schools. And they're also even more likely to graduate high school, right? So time and time again, these research studies come out that just reinforce the things that music educators already know. Music is great for kids, period. So if we know all of that, the question is, why do we struggle to recruit, engage, and maintain students in music programs? Well, a main reason is because as a field, we tend to hold on so tightly to tradition, even as our world continues to rapidly evolve and change. And when I talk with music educators, it's clear that for most of us, it comes down to knowledge or maybe lack thereof. So many of us are unclear on what words like diversity, equity, inclusion, cultural responsiveness, belonging, access, what those words even mean. And oftentimes, those words are often triggering for people, especially with the political landscape that we're all living under right now. Sometimes when I talk with folks, it's also a matter of big misconceptions and misunderstandings that they have about what those terms mean, again, because of the triggering that happens when folks hear those words. Now, this lack of understanding has clearly led to a ton of confusion, and quite frankly, it's holding us back as a field. But I'm committed to leading the change, and so that's why tonight I wanted to go solo for this episode to unpack what DEIAB even means for us as music educators, because what I know for sure is that music educators are some of the most hardworking folks that I know, right? We are the ones who come hours before contract hours. We stay hours late. We're working in the afternoons and evenings with our after-school rehearsals and coaching of different students and making sure they're ready for auditions and performances. We stay on the weekend coming in to work on different things. We take kids on trips, right? We are the hardest working folks. And I'm certain that when more of us have clarity, we'll really start to see change come to our field at a faster pace than what is happening right now. And let me also say this before I really get into it. DEIAB, such a huge topic. There is no way that I could dive all the way in and explain all the things in just one episode. So think of this episode as just an introduction, because this is really just going to be the tip of the iceberg. Let's start with diversity first. So when you hear that word, many things may come up for you. But according to Merriam-Webster, diversity means the condition of having or being composed of different elements. It's important to note that diversity includes race and ethnicity, but it's not only about race. It's also important to note that one person alone or one piece of a repertoire cannot be diverse. If you're not looking at me, I'm doing air quotes, diverse by itself. See, a lot of times, this is a huge pet peeve of mine. A lot of folks, times I hear folks say things like, we want to make sure we choose diverse composers, or we want to have diverse repertoire, but they're using it as a code to avoid saying the things that really need to be said. Like I said, one piece of repertoire is not diverse. Me by myself as a Black woman, I am not diverse because I'm only one person, right? Some of us are so uncomfortable with talking about race and ability, just as two examples, that rather than naming it for what it is, choosing repertoire that's written by a Black person or a Brown, Indigenous, or Asian composer, for example, folks will say diverse. But again, one person, one musician, one composer, one piece of repertoire is not diverse on its own. And so if you're finding that you're saying the word diverse a lot, actually, I just saw today an advertisement for a webinar that was saying that they were going to teach people about choosing culturally diverse repertoire. Again, what does that mean? Are you talking about like helping people to music educators to choose repertoire from Black, Brown, Indigenous, Asian composers? Are you helping them to choose music from different genres and styles? Because culture isn't just relegated to one person's race. Like, is it ability? Like, what do you mean by diverse? Say the thing that you are trying to say. So if you're finding that you're saying the word diverse instead of naming the race or ability or language or whatever that difference is that you're looking for diversity in, that requires some personal self-reflection, because that the use of the word diverse as code is problematic. And that's a whole other episode. Maybe I'll do another day. You can also think of diversity like this. In the PDs that I do with music teachers, I like to use the analogy of a school dance. Maybe you've attended a party or a dance at your school before. Let's say your high school's homecoming dance or prom back when you were in high school. Diversity is ensuring that everyone gets invited to the dance, not just some of the kids, but every kid gets invited. They know when and where the dance is going to be. They know all the details about the dance. Diversity is important because we want our music ed spaces to be inviting to all of our students. And when you look around a space and it doesn't reflect any pieces of your identity, it's hard to feel like you're welcome there. Nobody wants to be the only one. What I see working with music teams is that music programs that have a hard time attracting and retaining students oftentimes have a diversity issue, because the program is only inviting to a very particular kind of student. The repertoire that's chosen, the activities that's engaged in, the practices, the procedures, they're only appealing to a very particular kind of student. And as a result, other students are essentially repelled away from that program because they don't feel welcome and thus they don't participate. So if we want to tackle diversity head on, we have to make sure that we are inviting everyone and that our spaces look welcoming and inviting to everyone. And that means that we have to be diverse. And let me be more specific about what I mean, right? Diverse in the way that we run our program. So not just one way, not just the old fashioned band director on the podium, band students sitting, you know, there has to be a different way that we run our programs. Diverse in the racial, gender, ability, language, makeup of the composers and the musicians that we teach about. Diverse in the kinds of musical activities we engage students in. And that's just to name a few, right? If you notice that only a certain kind of student is attracted to being in your music program and other kids are clearly not wanting to be in your program, that's a clue that you need to look at how diverse your program is being in its programming and its offering, its practices and procedures. And again, it's not just about race, although that often does play a big part, right? When you don't see people that look like you or reflect parts of your identity. So let's go back to that school dance analogy for a moment. So we've made sure that everyone has gotten an invitation to the dance. That's diversity, right? Great. But just because you've been invited doesn't mean you actually have a way to get to the dance. If the dance is far away and you have to take a car, do you have access to a car or someone who can drive you? If the dance requires you to buy a ticket to attend, do you have the money to buy that ticket? See, in our music programs, diversity alone is not going to solve the problem of attracting and retaining students, especially those who are the most marginalized and have the least access to participation. A common discussion that comes up with the music teams that I work with when we're looking specifically at what obstacles and barriers may be affecting their ability to provide equitable access in their programs through the instruction and the curriculum, specifically as what I help music teachers with, they have put things in place to make things easier for kids. They often have. They've done things like figure out transportation, for example. So instead of only having schools be, you know, before or after school, they try to eliminate that problem because some kids, they only have transportation to get to school. So things have to happen during the school day. So planning a rehearsal in the afternoon, after school's over or in the morning before, they're not going to have a way there. So these teachers have been very thoughtful around making sure that rehearsals and courses are only offered during the school day. They also have done things like make sure that there are instruments that are just available for kids to use that don't require kids to have to buy their own. And all of these things are great. And please, yes, keep doing all of those things. And when we talk about access, right, so we started with diversity, now looking at access, some of those same teachers also express frustration to me that they're doing all of these things like providing transportation, removing financial requirements, yet still kids are not participating. It is quite frustrating when you're doing all of these things and you're being very intentional and thoughtful and then things are still not hitting, right? I get it. So let's look back at that dance analogy for a second. So inviting everyone to the dance doesn't guarantee that everyone will actually have a means to get there, right? And making sure that everyone has a means to get to the dance also doesn't mean that everyone will be invited or that they'll feel welcome when they get there. See, we both need diversity in our music programs, as well as access. One or the other alone doesn't really do much beyond a surface level, right? We can't just say all students are welcome in our music programs without taking intentional action to remove obstacles and barriers to access. We also can't remove the obstacles and barriers to access without ensuring that our programs are diverse, so that a variety of students will feel that they're welcome in those spaces, right? It's all about the actions that we take. And we have to be intentional because change is not gonna just happen by happenstance. Okay, so you've been invited to the dance, diversity. You were able to get to the dance, access. And now what happens when you get there? You could be at the dance, but when you get to the dance hall, you're standing off to the side by yourself. Or you could be at the dance, and when you get inside, someone invites you to dance. And that's two very different experiences, right? Inclusion is the act or practice of including and accommodating people who have historically been excluded. And that could be because of race, gender, sexuality, or ability. And I looked that up in the Merriam-Webster dictionary again. Because you see, it's not good enough to just invite kids into your music program. You need to consider what you need to do to accommodate them so that they can fully participate. especially when it comes to our students with disabilities. I think so many music educators, unfortunately, are just not fully prepared to include students in a manner that allows them to participate fully, whatever that might mean for that student. Different students, that's going to look differently, right? And as a result, I often see that students with disabilities may be in the music program, but they're kind of off to the side, right? They're not meaningfully participating. And this is inequity. To get to that meaningful inclusion, we as music educators need to consider the diverse needs of our students and what we need to put in place so that they can be at their best. When I work with music teachers in my graduate courses that I teach and in my year-long PD program, one of the first things that I ask them is, what are your students' strengths and what are their needs? And something really interesting happens when teachers answer this question. So interesting, in fact, that now I kind of ask it in a slightly different way. But when I was first asking these two questions, teachers every single time would tell me what their students do well. But then they would give me like a laundry list of all the things that the kids were doing wrong. And if you're not looking at me, I'm doing air quotes, wrong. But notice how I phrased that question, right? What are the students' strengths and what are their needs? Needs meaning literally, what do those kids need to be successful? What do you as a teacher need to do to not just invite them into your program, into your classroom, but intentionally put in place things that they can actually meaningfully participate? So actually, I ask that question slightly differently now. I ask, what are your students' strengths and what do your students need to have you put in place? Because I noticed when I just asked strengths and needs, I always got a laundry list of things where kids were doing wrong in that the eyes of that music educator. And that just revealed bias, right, is what that was. And it also didn't get to the heart of why I asked that question is high quality music programs are always intentionally designed to be the most inclusive and accommodating of all of the students who are either in the program currently or who could in the future be, right? That universal design element. Now, this might look like students need to have time to talk with each other during the lesson before they're going to share their thoughts out with the whole group. So you put some structures in place there. Or students might need you to make some adaptations to how you teach the repertoire. Perhaps you utilize both rote teaching and written notation. Or perhaps your students need visual cues. The list can go on and on and on, right? Carefully consider, are all of my students meaningfully participating? Remember what I said. Meaningful participation is going to vary from student to student, but really ask that question of yourself and then consider what you may need to do rather than trying to force the kid to fit into your mold. What do you just need to put in place in your program and in your classroom environment? Now, be careful that you don't limit the structures you put in place to only one or two specific students, unless it's absolutely necessary to do so, or if you're mandated by the student's IEP, right? But a lot of times, and I advocate for the teachers that I work with, that actually the better way for us to handle it is to utilize a universal design approach. Because when we put into place structures that are good for our most marginalized kids, it's actually good for everybody. And having it available to everyone allows music teachers to stop feeling like we're running like a hamster wheel trying to meet all of these. You know, often we have hundreds, sometimes thousands of students that we're working with, having to remember every individual student's little accommodation. Instead, what if we just lower the number of obstacles and get rid of as many barriers as we can and make sure that those pathways to success are just available to everybody? Utilizing a universal design approach really allows us to be more inclusive. All right, back to the dance analogy. So you've been invited to the dance. You had a way, that was diversity, right? You had a way to get there. Access. When you got into the dance hall, somebody invited you to dance, inclusion, great. And how are you going to dance? Is there a certain way you have to dance, or can you dance the way that you want to? Belonging is feeling accepted, cared for, and valued by others. Now, don't get it confused with welcoming, because I can feel welcome into a place, but then feel that in order for me to fit in with everyone there, I have to act a bit differently than I would normally in order to be accepted. Belonging means I can be my full self and I'll be accepted regardless. Now, this distinction between welcoming and belonging is a lot of why I think music programs, especially now in this weird, not quite post-pandemic world, like pandemic is still happening, but we're somewhere else, right? I think that's a key reason why many of our programs are struggling to attract kids. everywhere I go, and I've been on kind of a world tour, but not really because I haven't left the US, but I've been on a world tour all over the East Coast, even a little bit on the West Coast, talking to music teachers at conferences and different things where I've been speaking. And everywhere I go, folks remark how they cannot seem to get back to the number of students in their music programs that the numbers that they had during the pre-pandemic times. And while there are several different factors contributing to that, for sure, I think one big one is that kids have seen what it is like to be, find a sense of belonging in different places, right? Some kids who were participating before, they didn't fully feel like they belong, but they didn't see other options. But now they've seen other options and other ways and other groups that do foster a sense of belonging for them. And so they go there, right? And they don't come to the music program that didn't fully meet that need in the first place. As human beings, we crave a sense of belonging with others. We want to feel valued. We want to feel seen, heard, and accepted for exactly who we are. But in music education, so often we cling to this tradition, right? And this is how it's always been done, that we unintentionally turn many students off. Kids either have to get with the program and leave pieces of themselves at the door in order to participate, or they just choose not to participate at all, right? And nowadays, many are choosing not to participate at all. We may be able to attract the kids into our music programs, but without a sense of belonging, we'll never be able to retain them and build our programs from there. I think a lot about what our field might look like in 30 years. Without a sense of belonging, we're gonna continue to see these dwindling numbers in our music programs. And I wonder, will we even have music programs in 30 years if we can't figure this piece out, right? Consider your music program. Do you make space for kids to be exactly who they are? Or do you require a certain kind of way of being? All right, so back to the dance. So you've been invited to the dance, diversity. You had a way to get there, access. When you got to the dance hall, somebody invited you to dance, inclusion, and you were able to dance just how you like to, and everybody accepts you, belonging. Great. But who even decided that there was going to be a dance and not another kind of event? Who got to be a part of the decision about where it was going to take place, whether there was a cost associated, what kind of food or music would be available there? Who even decided that there was going to be an event at all? And that brings us to equity, right? Equity is everyone getting what they need in order to succeed. And in order for everyone to get what they need to succeed, there has to be shared decision making. And this is a major roadblock for us in the music education field, because quite honestly, and unfortunately, music education can be really elitist. And oftentimes the very people who need to be at the decision-making table because folks are making decisions for them, they're getting boxed out. The truth is, no one person can know everything about the needs that someone else has. That's just not a realistic expectation. But what you can do is intentionally look around and question who's here, who's not, who got to be a part of the decisions being made and who didn't, who's showing up fully and engaged and who's not quite, right? How we get to a reimagined music education field where all learners have a pathway to success is by working together in community so we can capitalize on all the shared knowledge to chart a new path. This is not work that anyone can do alone. Now, I feel like we know this as music educators, and yet I still think there's a bit of a shame around asking for help. I don't know for sure, but I suspect that some of us, because you know, when we become music teachers, we're so excited, right? We have these dreams of what our music program is gonna look like. We have these expectations of ourselves and of the kids, and then reality hits, right? And reality doesn't always meet that dream that we had. And that can be really hard. And it may leave you feeling like you've failed. I know I felt that way before. And I'm going to tell you this, that the only failure is really just in not trying at all. I think so many of us are aware that the issues exist, but because they aren't getting talked about as widely, we feel that it's just us, right? That we're alone in the struggle. But you are not alone. As I talk to teachers all over the country, we're music teachers, right? We are all struggling. We're all in it together. And I know for me, I definitely struggled, especially those first few years teaching, until I really made the decision to commit to refining my craft and figuring out what was going to be best for my students, which quite honestly didn't match the dream that I initially had. But then that dream became something different, and actually it became better, right? If somebody would have asked me 13 years ago if I would be doing what I'm doing now, or even doing what I was doing 5 years ago, I never would have believed you, right? I would have thought that I was going to be, you know, a secondary ensemble director with my kids' ensembles, doing all these honor groups and traveling and doing this and doing that. But quite honestly, in my classroom and in my programs, the emphasis on concerts and performing was not my, it became not my goal, right? My goal was really to help my students to use music as a vehicle for them to better understand themselves, others around them, and the world that they were going to go out in. And I got so much more joy from working with my students to realize what that new dream could look like than the previous dream, right? So I know I talked a lot about these different ideas, these different terms, right? Diversity, equity, inclusion, access, belonging. And I just gave a little tip of the iceberg, right? When it comes to unpacking what those terms mean in our music education space. You know, as I said before, this is such a huge topic, and it's going to be one that I'm going to continue to unravel. But in the meantime, I'd love to know your questions and your thoughts about this episode where I just gave you an introduction, and let me know what you'd like for me to discuss next in a future episode in regards to better understanding DEIAB in music education, because like I said before, I'm committed to leading the way, and I want to make sure that my folks, my music education folks, that we have the knowledge that we need, because we will work hard, but we need the knowledge and the understanding and the know-how, right, to be able to do that. So let me know what parts you want me to unravel next so I can make sure that you got what you need. All right, so let's wrap up for this episode. To all of my listeners out there, again, thank you so much for listening. As I mentioned at the top of the episode, this is officially halfway through our first season, which is so wild and wonderful. When I had this idea last year to start a show, to have a platform for the conversations that I want to have more of, and quite frankly, that my awesome music educator friends, many of them you've gotten to meet this season so far, these are the conversations that we're having. More of us need to be having these conversations, and I didn't quite know how it was going to be received, but I had an idea. I just put it out in the world, and I could not be more excited and maybe a little humbled for how beautiful and tremendous the response has been to the show. So just thank you again to all of you that come live every week. Thank you to those of you that listen, you know, once the episodes are dropped. And thank you to those of you that are sharing, because I can see that the audience is growing. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. And if you have not already, make sure that you click that subscribe button on my YouTube channel, and also sign up for my email list. That's where I send the notifications every time a new episode is getting ready to be recorded, like I'm doing right now, recorded every other Tuesday, and also when they're available. So make sure that you hit that subscribe button, get on the email list so that you get notifications. And if you and your music team are looking for support to refine your music program's environment and instruction to better attract, engage, and retain your students in your programs by centering culturally responsive and equitable practices, I invite you to reach out to me. Now is a great time to start the conversation around PD, coaching, and consulting support for this summer and also for next school year. I'm booking teams right now and would love to support you and your team. So head over to my website, ashleycuthbertson.com. Click the tab to contact me and send me a message, and let's get the conversation going about what a partnership with me and your music team could look like. All right, thank you again so much to everybody out there listening. I will see you again next time on the Music EdQuity Chat Show.